So, what do you think about the Olympia today? Do you think it's popularity or it's what do you think about the prestige of it, the popularity? Do you think it's the same today as it was back in the 90s?
No, not even
No.
close. I think there's a lot of factors why. I think the fact that the IFBB or the NPC give away so many pro cards, they've watered it down. I mean, I think in 2019 they gave away 1,072 pro cards in 1 year.
Are you? They probably didn't give away 1,000 in the whole decade of the 90s.
Exactly, that's my point. And at the end of the day, it's become it's no longer a class of elite athletes like it used to be. I mean, back in my day, when I turned pro, only the overall winner got the pro card. One guy and one woman a year out of England got the pro card. When they're giving 1,072 pro cards away in a year, and at some shows they're giving 20, 30 pro cards away, it takes away from the meaning of being a pro, in my opinion. Now you're one of many rather than one of few. And it's not, but when you looked at any top line Olympia lineup back in the day, every single one of those guys was a Mr. Universe winner or a Mr. A top title winner. And a lot of the guys now, they've never won a show.
Yeah.
And I think that takes away from it a lot. The title of an IFBB pro now doesn't mean what it used to mean. A lot of IPV pros have been very upset with me for saying that, but it's just a fact. It's become almost like a membership club because all those pros are paying money each year, and not quite a lot of money to be a pro. And now the IFBB have made it where if you don't, let's say you don't decide not to compete for a couple of years because you get an injury, and you want to compete in 2021, but you haven't competed since 2019, they'll make you back pay the 2020 and the 2 years that you didn't compete before you can compete as a pro. Well,
Wow.
me, that's not, I think that's one of the biggest reasons why it's happened. And the direction that they've gone with the sport. I mean, the classic bodybuilding division is really the new, in my opinion, is really the new bodybuilding. It should never have to been invented. Classic bodybuilding should never have. They've had to do it because of the way the open bodybuilding's gone. But to me, that is bodybuilding. Classic bodybuilding is bodybuilding. And unfortunately, they've gone away from the small waistlines and the conditioning that was. I mean, you look at when Lee Haney was competing. You look at the conditioning of those guys compared to the conditioning of the guys now. The guys now are bigger, but they don't really look that much bigger, in my
No,
opinion,
no.
because everything's bigger. So the silhouette, it's not an improved silhouette, if you know what I mean. The waistline's got bigger, everything's got bigger, so it's just a bigger version of what they were. And I don't think that's always a better thing.
No, and you know what it is too? Back in the days of Lee Haney, as you say, when you hit a pose, every single muscle group was clearly distinguishable from the next.
Yes.
Whereas today, it almost looks like one giant blob of muscle.
I think that's because they're getting so big.
It's way too big.
I don't know what these guys are weighing when they walk on stage. And I don't get me wrong, I respect them for building that much muscle. I'm a bodybuilder. I always thought I would love the freakier guys, but as it's actually transpired and these guys have got freakier, I don't think they've got better. I don't think it's a better look. And honestly, it's like my son's 20-year-old. I aspired to be a bodybuilder. I saw Lee Haney, I saw Tom Platz, and I was gobsmacked by them. I just wanted to look like that. I think a lot of people now, they look at a lot of the champions now, and not for every bodybuilder, but for some of them, they just look at them. I don't see why they would aspire to be like that. It's not an achievable goal, in my opinion.
Well, yeah, it seems like, well, I mean, I met Lee Haney in, I think, 1988. He was doing a posing seminar in New York City, and I met him, and I was blown away by how the guy looks.
I was
And
too.
my brother was always a very, very strong kid, and he shook Lee Haney's hand, and he said it felt like Lee Haney could have ripped his arm off. That's how strong he was. At which I was taken aback because my brother's like a power lifter,
Yeah.
and Lee Haney was just—I I mean, I think that's just about as big as you can get and still look classic, still look good. And he was came in, I think his heaviest, he was like 252 or something like that.
Yes.
And but, you know,
and then you look at, I mean, I don't know what, to me, the best bodybuilder I ever saw personally, and I competed against him, was Flex Wheeler. Flex Wheeler at his best, that's the closest thing to a perfect physique I've ever seen. Personally.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's the only guy I looked at and literally shook my head and thought, I can't beat him. And yeah. I hate to admit that.
Sure.
But if Flex was on, I don't think anybody could beat him. I don't think anybody was better than him. But he didn't always win.
No, no.
But in fairness, he wasn't always on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but when Flex, I think my last ever show was the 98 Arnold Classic. And I remember being at that. This is one of the reasons why I retired, I think. I remember standing watching him and Nasser, and I don't know who the third athlete was, going through the compulsories, and they were hitting the back of my biceps, so they were facing me. And I remember looking at Flex and just thinking, you know what? I don't know if I can beat that. That's just, I mean, his wrists were like this.
Mm-hmm.
His ankles, all his joints were so small. And like we were talking about earlier, that's just God-given genetics. I mean, you can't make your wrists smaller, you know?
No, at all.
The way it was put together was incredible. But it's a shame the way bodybuilding went. They kept rewarding the bigger, bigger guys. And I don't think that's always better.
No, but, it's a matter. I think there was, at one point, Flex was up against Ronnie. Wasn't he up against Ronnie Coleman for first and second?
Yeah, that was the first year Ronnie won, I believe.
Yeah, and I saw Flex's face. He was clearly disappointed that he had lost. And, you know, that could have really been the turning point for bodybuilding had they it gone could, with yeah. Flex.
Yeah, it could.
Right? Because, you know, I'm not going to be popular for saying this either, is that I don't really like Ronnie's physique.
I'll be honest with you. Personally, I don't think genetically it was as good as Flex Wheeler.
He
didn't have the flowing lines Flex Wheeler had. I mean, most of my career, me and Ronnie Coleman were placing more or less the same.
Yeah.
I get fifth, he gets sixth or whatever. And he didn't have the most flowing physique, but he attained such a massive amount of muscle in condition. And then that opened the door for Jay Cutler. Jay Cutler was another impressive human being, but he didn't have that small waistline. He didn't have those, his quads didn't sweep from his hip. His sweep started quite low. And a lot of those things wouldn't have won in the 80s.
Right, right. You're right.
It changed. And you can't blame the athletes. You've got to blame the judges.
100%. 100% it's on them. Yeah, you know, I think what happened is the judges, from a financial perspective, the people who are running the IFBB or whatever, the men's open bodybuilding is really a zoo. It's a freak show.
Yeah.
Right. And then people like to see that, as much as you can deny it, they like coming to see how massive a human being can get. You know.
But like I said, it's like, you put Lee Haney on a stage at 250 and you put some of these guys on stage that are walking at probably 50 pounds heavier than him. I know which I think is the freakiest look.
Sure.
I think Lee Haney is the freakier look. But the common sense tells you if they get bigger, they're going to be freakier, but it just doesn't work that way.
No, unfortunately, Mother Nature and the rules of aesthetics take over. Okay, exactly. That's what right?
Yep.
So, you know, this guy in classic physique, I think his name is Chris Bumstead. He won recently.
Yeah.
He has a pretty nice classic physique.
Great physique.
Yeah.
That's bodybuilding, though.
Yeah. That's what bodybuilding should look like.
It shouldn't have to be called classic, but it is. We've gone to that route. It's just, I think a lot of the lines get blurred. They open a new division and then they let the boundaries get. They let them overstep the boundaries, like men's physique. The men's physique class started out as an attainable look that you would see on a beach. You know, the extreme of what you see on a beach. Well, they're really bodybuilders in board shorts now.
Yes, yes, right.
And that's not what it was supposed to have been. So no. Now the guys that are actually going in like a men's physique athlete are getting drowned out by the mass monsters. Well, that was never supposed to be men's physique. And if they're not careful, the same thing's going to happen with classic bodybuilding.
Yeah, you'll get it right. It'll be a vicious circle eventually, yeah. Right? It could be. Yeah.
And all your lines are going to get blurred, and they're just all going to be freaky bodybuilders, either in board shorts and classic trunks or in regular posing trunks. They try to cap it with the weight division and the height division, but some of these guys just seem to get by it. I don't know how they do it, because I mean, I think Chris Bumstead, from the year before to this year, the difference he made was incredible, and I don't know how he made weight. I'm sure he did.
Yeah.
I'm not saying he didn't, but it's just, I don't know. I think all the lines have got blurred, unfortunately. And I think bodybuilding should never have swayed away from the small waist and the symmetry and the balance. That's what makes it an art form, because it is an art form. It's not, it's a sport, but it's an art form. You know, the posing, a lot of the open bodybuilders, I don't think they pose very well.
Oh, that's it. I don't think they practice the posing like you guys did. Because you,
I mean, I used to watch posing routines of like Lee Haney, and literally I could go, I'm sure you were the same. You go back to like the Battle for Gold or the 88 Olympia, and you knew every pose they did in order. I could listen to their posing routine now after not watching it for 10 years, because I studied everything they did and I mimicked everything they did. I don't think bodybuilders do that now, because it's all this crapping and the most muscular.
Yeah. Well, you know, like I said earlier, you'll never see a person pull off a crucifix today. They don't have the waistlines for it. It's impossible. Their front double biceps don't look good. You know, it's, I don't know. I think that it's just, they put classic physique in there because they knew that between the board shorts and the open was too much gap.
Yes.
Right. So you had to put something in the middle. And that's, you really have bodybuilding is classic physique. And then you have the zoo animals come out, the open bodybuilders, the freak show. You know, which is entertaining to watch, don't get me wrong. But like, I don't look at them and be like, I never looked at any, there's no bodybuilder today I look at and say, I want to look like that. Not one.
That's my point. That's my point. And that's, it's like with my son, I think I was getting to this earlier. I'm almost glad that he didn't want to be a competitive bodybuilder, because I know if he did, he'd want to be the best, which means he'd want to do open, which means he'd have to follow what they're judging for, which is complete mass. And it's like when I was competing, like that crucifix pose I did, I mimicked it off Lee Haney. That's where I studied him and I watched him, and I wanted to be, you know, my version of Lee Haney. And I don't know. It's just, it's changed a lot, man. It's changed a lot. But I still love the sport. I can't say I don't. I love the sport. I'm hoping it's going to come back around.
I hope so, too. I love the sport, too. Once it takes hold of you and gets in your blood, it's over. You're a fan for life, period. And you almost hate yourself for loving it. Even though, you know.
It can be a curse as well as a blessing, but... It's an incredible sport when it is a sport, when it's done correctly and it's done healthily. It doesn't have to be unhealthy. It doesn't have to be, you know, I mean, when I was studying Lee Haney and a lot of these guys, they lived a very healthy lifestyle, you know.
Yeah.
And nowadays, I just don't think it's gone from being super healthy to being super unhealthy.
I agree. Totally.
And it should never have done that, because who wants to aspire to be unhealthy?
Right, right.
Nobody does, really, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's so interesting. Like, not only does it not look good, it's unhealthy. So there's really no attraction whatsoever.
No. Except females don't find it attractive. Women don't find it attractive.
At all, yeah.
It's going to kill you in the end, in the long run. And you've got a small niche of people that really respect it. And it was still a small niche of people when we was competing, but it still had all the other attractions to it. You know, you consider yourself to be healthy. You consider yourself to be an athlete, really, I guess. And now it's almost turned into a lab test.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't think, you know, PEDs are going to be in every sport. I understand that. And that is every sport. I don't care what sport it is. If it's a physical sport, they're going to be involved. But I think when it's so prevalent and it's the first thing people think about rather than how hard they train or how well they eat, when the first thing that, I mean, a lot of young bodybuilders, I hear them, they don't ask about what the diet is. They don't ask how to train more intensely. They ask what to take. And I think that's, we're missing the point somewhere.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I remember years ago, it was normal for a kid to go to a gym and you would train completely natural for 3, 4, 5 years.
I did. You did.
Before you even considered the big, and it was a big deal to then, you know, to make that jump onto anabolic steroids, you know. But today it seems like it's like a prerequisite. You go to the gym, you take steroids, period.
Exactly. You buy your chicken or you buy your protein powder, you buy your steroid, you buy your gym membership all at the same time.
Yeah.
It's crazy, really.
It really is. And the interesting thing too is that a lot of people go to the gym for the first time. They've never studied biomechanics. They've never studied, you know, the old school training methods like Arthur Jones, for example. Even Joe Weider's.
Arthur Jones was way ahead of his time.
Way ahead of his time. Yeah.
I mean, people don't understand. I think the biggest mistake that people make is they think old school is an old fashioned way of thinking. Mm-hmm. Well, the human body hasn't changed. The human digestive system hasn't changed.
Right.
Look at the bodybuilders that came out in the 80s, in the 90s. And I'm not just talking about people I competed against before me and after me. They had incredible physique. So why are the methods they used outdated? They shouldn't be. They work. Right. If it ain't broken, don't fix it.
So let's talk about a little bit about dieting, training, drugs, and genetics. All right. Now, of those, let's say diet, training, drugs, and genetics, which one do you think is the most important in terms of your success as a bodybuilder?
Personally, training.
Training.
But looking back, I think there's, after the discussion we've had earlier, I think genetics are a major key to it. And
right.
Not just how you're put together, how your body responds to things. How your body responds to the training, how your body responds to the food. I mean, if you had seen pictures of me when I first started training, you would never have said I would end up on the Mr. Olympia stage. Never. No way.
Really?
Oh, no. I'm telling you, I was a skinny kid. I was like this.
Uh-huh.
Literally, when I was 10, 11 years old, my knees were wider than my thighs.
Yeah.
So it's not, you wouldn't have said I had good genetics. It's just that I responded very well to the training. I responded very well to the eating. My body did respond very well. And I think that is a major influence. I think how your muscle bellies are tied in, your genetic, mm-hmm. your genetics as far as insertions of muscles and how the flow, that's, you can't even tell that until you've developed to a certain extent. I mean, there's videos of me on YouTube competing at 17 years old. And again, you really wouldn't have thought I had great genetics. But as my muscle bellies filled out, they looked more impressive. And some other people look really good without having been filled out, without having the really good muscle density and size. But as they get bigger, it gets cumbersome. It gets ugly.
And yeah, and interesting.
It's very hard to judge. I mean, a thing I say nowadays when I do my posing seminars is, to me, if you're talking about a Marvel comic, which most bodybuilders used to be into Marvel comics, I know I did. I used to do a lot of pencil drawings. And a bodybuilder should be like Superman, not the Thing.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
That's the best way I can describe it. And if you know Marvel comics, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. And that's a lot of that's God-given. A lot of that's just how your parents, really, you know, who your parents are and how you put together.
Yeah.
But I still believe down deep
down. Mom and Dad, I want my money back.
But I still believe deep down that you can get great genetics in someone, but if they're lazy and they're not willing to work, they're not going to make it.
Right. Well, that's true. Many people who are genetically gifted tend to not work as hard because of the fact that they're genetically gifted.
So gifted, they feel like they don't have to.
But when they do, it's over.
Yeah. If you combine genetics with hard work ethic, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
People are in trouble. But usually those two things don't go together. It's like, right. I know that my son played football for a few years, and you'll normally find that the kids that are super fast genetically are the ones that will leave the practice first and be the last to get there. The lazy. And the kid that doesn't have that genetics maybe as much, he'll be the first one there, he'll work the hardest. Once you combine those two things, natural talent with hard work, mm-hmm. or a hard work ethic, that's when you're going to get champion.
Yeah, one of the exceptions to that rule, I just keep thinking back to Richie Gaspari from the 1980s, competing against Lee Haney. Not the best genetics, but boy, he did. Man, did he do? He worked like an animal to get where he went, where he was.
If he'd have had Lee Haney's genetics, nobody would have beaten him for years.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, he was an animal in terms of his work ethic.
I saw him compete in Sweden. I'm not sure what year that was. I think it was 89 maybe. But me and my brother went to Sweden to watch him, and I believe he got third that year. But even when he was like his heaviest, his conditioning was just incredible. You know, his posing was incredible. But yeah, he I think we and you probably had the same mindset. We looked at people like that, and we wanted to have the same determination, the same work ethic. Tom Platz was one of my heroes because he just never gave up. Tom Platz didn't have great genetics.
No. Well, except for his quads.
Yeah, his quads. Well, nobody will ever beat those quads. But you look at the rest of his physique, he didn't have good genetics.
Right.
But he had an incredible work ethic.
Yeah. Well, you know, some people say he should have won the 81 Olympia.
I agree with that.
Yeah. And speaking of politics, too, I always thought one of my favorite bodybuilders was Mike Mensa. I thought he was fantastic.
Yeah.
Very complete, top to bottom, thick, pose great. I thought he was great.
You look at that 1980 Olympia in Sydney, Australia. Yeah. Well, he probably should have won that.
Yeah. And what people don't know, too, is that in 1979, Mike Mensa won the Olympia, but there were two classes.
All right, yeah.
But he won and Frank Zane won. And then they had to compete against each other, and Frank Zane beat him. Yeah, right. he had a perfect score of 300.
Wow.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yep. Yeah, when I was competing, we just had one Olympia. I know they've got back to two classes now, but yeah, there was only one. So when you think about someone like Lee Labrada and Lee Priest doing so well in the open class, I mean, kudos to them.
Really? Yeah. I mean, you know, the Olympia, we know when Arnold and Franco were competing, there was two classes too.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the in terms of diet, training, drugs, and genetics, where do you rate the drugs?
Honestly, I'd say they're last.
Dead last.
Yeah, I think they're last. I don't think you can achieve the ultimate and compete against people that are not using them, but I don't think that's a priority. When I was competing, I honestly feel like the harder you train and the more disciplined you were with your diet, it was like a badge of honor.
Mm-hmm.
Then the drugs came in, you know, to recover. But and different people had different ideas. You know, there was different people that prioritized it more than others. But I remember when I won the Junior Mr. Universe in, what year was that? That'd have been 1988. I won the Junior Mr. Britain and the Junior Mr. Universe. I remember being in the parking lot between the pre-judging and night show, talking to four bodybuilders that were all a few years older than me. But they were laughing at me, just laughing their asses off at me, because what I used in a week, they use in a day, I believe.
Right.
It was absolutely insane. But not everybody was like that. And a lot of it's to do with how you respond to things too. You know, I could get away with doing small amounts and getting good results. So I was like, why risk doing anything else?
Sure.
But I still got people criticize me and tell me that if I did more, I could have been better. But I used to just want to train harder than everybody else and be more disciplined than everybody else. You know, that was kind of my attitude. I don't know if it's from where you grow up or the era we grew up in, but just a different mindset, I guess.
I think so. Well, I think back then it was expected that you had to work like an animal. You know, that was just the mindset, period. And you know what it comes down to too is that back in the 90s, there were gyms that were very hardcore for the hardcore bodybuilders. Now, it stands to reason that if those gyms are gone, then the hardcore trainer is gone too, for the most part, because when you go to a gym that's not hardcore, you're out of your element. How do you train hard there? You can't. And in fact, some places will throw you out.
Yeah, no.
Right?
Yeah.
And then add a mask or two to your face. And how are you supposed to train? It's just, it's insane these days.
Yeah.
But that's another conversation. so what kind of, in terms of food, did you do this 8 meals a day kind of thing? And how many calories were you taking in more or less at your biggest?
I was probably taking in 5,000 or 6,000 calories a day in the off season.
Okay.
It wasn't always super clean. I kept my protein high. Basically eggs, chicken. I never really did fish unless I was dieting. So it was basically eggs and chicken was my main sources. I was never a big red meat eater, but I would hammer the eggs. High carbs. I don't think even when I was dieting, I went much below 250 grams of carbs a day. I always kept my carbs very, very high, probably in the 600 grams a day region. And because I was naturally a skinny kid, so I had a very fast metabolism. Mm-hmm. So I literally had to force calories down my throat just to get the size up. I think I told you the story about the desiccated liver tablets when I was like 17, right?
Share it with us.
I in order to gain weight, when I was probably the first 2 or 3 years of my bodybuilding, I was literally force feeding myself, almost being sick doing it. And I started taking desiccated liver, which was very popular back in our day. It was vacuum dried liver in tablets, big tablets. And I used to take 20 with each meal. So that was 24, 60, 80, 100, 120, 120 tablets a day.
Wow.
But one night I got home from the gym and I'd forgotten to take my desiccated liver tablets to work with me. So literally I finished my meal. I always used to have ice cream. I think that night I had a steak, a big load of baked potato with butter and cheese on it. And then I realized that I'd not taken my desiccated liver tablets. So I was never a guy that could take a handful at a time. It was one at a time for me. So I sat there and took 120 desiccated liver tablets one at a time. And when I finished it, I sat bottle upright in bed and projectile vomited the whole thing across my bedroom. Well, I was 17 years old at the time. I didn't have a lot of money. So I was flicking through my vomit, basically, and picking out the desiccated liver tablets and retaking them. And my mother walked up to me. And they were going to call a psychiatrist on me because they thought I was literally mad. But the reason I did that isn't just because of money. It's because I knew if I threw that up, my body couldn't use that protein to grow. So right. I knew at a young age how important protein was. And so I started retaking the tablets.
All right. Well, it's just a testament to how frugal you are sometimes.
Well, there you go. Yes.
Well, that's interesting. How many eggs can you consume in one day? How many do you eat in one day?
I used to do like 17 whole eggs with a cup and a half of porridge. I used to do that. I remember I got free eggs for about 3 years off a local egg farmer because there was salmonella scare in England. And I literally lived on that meal 6 or 7 times a day for about a year and a half when I was trying to gain size. So I used to buy a big sack of oatmeal, a big box of bananas, and get all my eggs. And I would just do whole eggs, oatmeal. I'd put sugar in it, regular sugar in it, and I'd slice a banana up in it. And I'd do that 6, 7 times a day. And I grew like a weed on that.
Wow.
So I was eating 17 eggs times 6, whatever that is.
Holy mackerel. Okay, so you 17.
You're going to do the math now, aren't you?
Indeed. That's 102 eggs in a day.
Yeah.
102.
Probably not recommended. Looking back now, the cholesterol was probably a bit high. But I was young. I was training like a madman. And the frugal me didn't want to waste the 3 grams of protein that was in the yolk.
Right? Well, there's a lot of people who don't believe in the egg white thing. They don't believe in it. They think you should just eat the whole egg.
I think it depends how many you're eating. If you're eating over 100 a day, I think it's probably not a wise thing to do. We all did unwise things back in the day to get bigger. But I didn't do that for a long time. I would probably say 6 months I actually did every meal like that. And then I started cutting back on my yolks a little bit. But I still never completely eliminated the yolks, you know. Unless I was really close to a show, then it'd be just egg whites.
Now, in terms of complexity, we're talking about chicken, eggs, and oatmeal. This is not complicated.
That's really not. You know, one thing that drives me insane nowadays, a lot of the modern day trainers always talk about macros. And I have a lot of clients that have trained with trainers that are obsessed with macros. And they'll ask my clients what macros they're using. And the thing is, not all carbohydrates are created equal. Not all proteins are created equal. All fats are created equal. You know, the protein in pork, for instance, is, I think, something like 40% bioavailable, as opposed to the protein in chicken, which is like 85 to 90% bioavailable. An egg is the only thing in nature that is more or less 100% bioavailable. And if people don't understand what bioavailability is, it's how much of the protein you eat you can actually use.
Right.
You know, it's if the amino acid chain, the balance of the amino acids is the same as your muscle. And the only perfect thing you could eat, really, the only perfect thing would be another human being, but that's illegal, so we can't do that.
Right, right. I mean, I heard that's called the Jeffrey Dahmer diet. I understand. So, I mean, basically speaking, if you eat 10 grams of protein from an egg source, you're gonna digest 9 or 10 of those grams are going to your muscles.
Exactly.
And other proteins are not that efficient, where if you ate 10 grams, you might only get 4 grams that went to the muscle. So you're I think they call that a protein efficiency ratio or something along those lines. So yeah, I understand that's important. And the carbohydrates, of course, you have complex, you have simple. The glycemic index plays a part.
Glycemic index is the main thing people miss. You can't compare broccoli to table sugar. They're both carbohydrates. But if you got all your macros in a day from sugar, thinking you're going to get in great condition and feel great is delusional. You need carbohydrates that are higher on the glycemic index and take longer to digest and release energy slowly into your bloodstream rather than just dumping it all in one go.
Right.
If you have raw sugar, then it's going to spike your insulin. And then you're going to get, once that insulin forces the blood sugar out of your blood, then you're going to get a drop in blood sugar. So you're going to get high and then a low, which is not conducive to being an athlete or to being able to train. And I think people just miss the point with proteins. I mean, vegetable protein is not a complete protein. You can make it a complete protein if you mix it with other proteins. That's called, I forgot what the name for that is. Basically, you're using different proteins with different amino acid profiles. You add them together and then you get a full amino acid profile and it's a complete protein then.
Right.
But I think back in the day, the old school bodybuilders, the 70s bodybuilders, they do steak and eggs. There's a lot of reasons why that worked.
Right. You
know, steak is high in creatine. And even though steak is not the best protein, I think it's like 60 or 70% bioavailable, the egg made up for the missing amino acids in it. So it made it complete protein. It seems quite Neanderthal to eat like that, but there's a reason why it works.
Sure. And not only that, but from a perspective of taste, you can't beat the good old steak, can you?
Exactly. You know? Yeah.
So in addition to this, like, Your training philosophy, there's different training philosophies out there, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, some people go with the high volume. Some people say the low volume, like the Mike Mentzer system, the hit training Dorian used to. Mm-hmm. You know, very low sets, but very high intensity. Whereas Arnold was more of probably that, you know, 20 sets and spent hours in the gym. Where do you fall on that scale?
More towards the Mike Mentzer style of training, but I didn't agree with as low as he did. Mm-hmm. I don't believe one set of anything. I believe it can make you grow, but I think the risk of injury is too high. Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, like for chest, I did two exercises. I do one pressing movement and one flying movement. And I change the order and I change the angles. But basically, that's how I do it. And for back, I do two exercises, one chinning movement and one rowing movement. And I would go balls out, intense as I could on everything. I'd go to complete failure. I use a lot of drop sets.
Right.
So I would be failing multiple times within a set. To me, the theory I used was the more you could get a muscle to fail, completely fail, not your mind, but the muscle to fail, the more times you could get that to happen within a workout, and that workout be within 45 minutes to an hour. And the only reason any workout lasted an hour was recovery between sets. Like on leg day, legs would take longer than shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
Just because you needed to breathe so much more in between sets. But I guess I was more along the high intensity. But I think the form of the exercise is very important. How you perform the movement. You know, if you're not, like you see so many guys with a poor chest, they've got immense shoulders and immense arms and no chest development. Because when they're pressing, they're not really dominating with the chest. They're dominating with their auxiliary muscles. They're dominating with, you see people who don't have any lower lat development. They don't do a scapular retraction when they're pulling or rowing. They use their arms a lot. And you can disengage your biceps from a back movement if you actually use scapular retraction correctly. And then you see on someone like Kai Green, his lower lats are like ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's
when they really do engage the lats. I think with any body part you train, you've got to have a mind-muscle connection to it.
Yeah, I think the mind-muscle connection, you know, that comes with only experience, basically.
It does.
You can certainly stand over a guy and mentor him and teach him, and eventually he'll get it. But it definitely, it's practice and experience.
Yeah, it is, without a doubt.
And, you know, it's funny because when you first go to a gym, you might do your set and you'll fail. And once you get that mind-muscle connection, then you start to realize, uh-oh, now the pain's going to come.
Yes.
Because now the mind is, your mind is going to fail first, not your body. Yeah. Because the pain is going to be at the point where you're going to want to give up.
Well, I think that's where it separates the man from the boys. That's where we were talking about being civilized. I think once you get, when you're uncivilized, you just push through that. You don't care. I mean, I used to have the mentality when I trained. It was like a boxer that was getting punched in the face and just going, come on, come on. The more it hurt, the more I wanted it to hurt.
Right.
Because my philosophy back in the day was, I'm going to train so hard, my muscles are either going to rip in two or it's going to grow. It's either going to die or it's going to grow. There's only two options for it. That's right. How hard I'm going to train. And that was the mentality, you know. And that honestly, that was why the gyms were so buzzing back then.
Yes, that's true. You know, Lee Haney used to say, you have to change your mindset where pain, he said, I changed my mindset, pain became pleasure.
Yes. And it doesn't, it's just that you know that the more pain you endure, the bigger, the more gains you're going to get, the more muscle you're going to grow. So then you welcome that pain because the more painful it is, the more results you're going to get.
Right. It's a reward system almost.
Exactly. Exactly. Right? Yeah.
So there were times I went in the gym and I really wanted to experiment with myself. How far, what happens, you know? Let's say you're doing leg extensions, which is one of the most painful exercises you can do, and calf raises as well. But leg extensions, for example, they start to burn, and it burns, and it continues to burn. The more reps, and I always thought to myself, well, what would happen if I just kept going? Am I going to go numb? Am I going to pass out? What's going to happen? So I always tried to push myself further and further into the zone to see what would happen. Yeah. You know, and I mean, obviously, I'm still here, so. You know, but I found that eventually it gets to a certain level and then it fades off. It starts to fade off the pain.
I think your body produces natural painkillers.
Yeah.
Because normally what happens is you get the intense pain and then literally it goes numb.
Yeah.
You can't feel it anymore. It just, you lose the feeling from it. I remember doing that with leg extensions. I do like multiple drop sets on leg extensions. I'd fail on my first one, then lower it and carry on and And I get to the point where I couldn't stand up. I couldn't straighten my leg with 5 pounds on there.
Right.
You know, it's just gone. It's just completely gone. But very few people are willing to go that far.
You got that right. And then to the next day, you can't even sit down properly because you're still so much pain.
But then when you do it that often, you don't get sore from it.
Yeah.
You have to change the order. You have to change things up because you can train so hard that your body just gets used to training that hard. And that's when I would sometimes throw in a volume workout. For instance, I'd always maybe start with an incline barbell on chest and then go to flies. But every now and again, I would put in what I call a reset workout where I'd do the whole workout just with flies. I'd do incline flies, flat flies, decline flies, and it would cripple me. But if I did that same workout again, it wouldn't hurt.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So I always change angles and change orders of things to try and get the results because it gets to the point where just training harder don't work anymore.
Right.
You've got to change the angles and the order and things like that up to keep getting results.
I'm also a big believer that if you change the angles, if you change the angles constantly, you're also improving the shape of your muscles.
Well, you're developing the whole muscle. If you just do flat bench, you're only the major stress is in a certain part of your pec. When you change the angle, because I'd go like smaller, then another, then I'd come back down. You know, I'd always change angles from one workout to the next, not within the same workout. Because I think too many people try and work the whole chest every workout. Well, you can't do that. You've got to pick your fights, you know. Mm-hmm. You've got to blast your chest from a flat position one time and then blast it from an incline and then a different incline. So you're always hitting the muscle from a different angle. And that way you get complete development.
Right.
If you always do the same workouts, that you're only going to develop your muscles in a certain way. So if right. you want to fully develop a muscle from insertion to insertion, you know, from bottom to top and everywhere you can, you've got to use a variety of different angles and exercises.
Right. And if you take guys like Robbie Robinson and Arnold Schwarzenegger, and you look at the way their biceps are peaked.
Yeah.
I believe, obviously a lot of that's genetic. Yeah. However, I believe that the angles and the way that they trained were partially responsible for how good those arms looked.
I agree.
You know, and you know, Robbie Robinson said he said that using the weights is like using a paintbrush if you're an artist. You know, and he's absolutely right. It's a tool. It's a tool, and you're creating a physique just like an artist creates a painting.
Robbie was an incredible bodybuilder. He was actually here at my house a few months ago.
Yeah,
he was an incredible guy. Incredible. It still looks incredible now.
Yeah, I think he has a book out now too, or something, doesn't he? I think he put a book out.
I need to get that. I need to read it.
And did you follow a lot of the pre-exhaustion techniques that Mensah advocated?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. In fact, what everybody used to ask me how I train my legs because my legs are one of my best body parts, and my squatting motion, which I had knee surgery at 17 from squatting. I was squatting like over 600 pounds at 16 years old. Blew both my knees out. So I never pre-squatted ever again. I always did hack squats. But my hack squats would be the very last thing I did. I would start off with an isolation move for hamstrings, leg curls usually. Then I'd do my compound move for hamstrings. Then I'd do my isolation move for quads, which is leg extensions. And then my very last exercise, while I literally couldn't walk, I'd walk up to the hack squat and go as heavy as I could on the hack squat after I'd completely pre-exhausted everything. And it always worked very well for me because the pre-exhaustion makes sense. As a bodybuilder, you want to build the muscle, which means stretching the muscle out as much as possible with the heaviest weight possible. But if you pre-exhaust it, then you're not overloading the joint. So by the time I got to the hack squat, my muscles were 60, 70% fried. So now the amount of weight I needed to get my muscles to fail was probably a third of what I would have used if I'd have started with that squatting motion. So now by doing that, you're saving your joint stress. You're taking the load off the joints. Because I had those surgeries on my knees, it made perfect sense. And what happened with me when I started doing that pre-exhaustion, it worked so well for my quads, I incorporated it into the rest of my workouts. So I would 9 times out of 10, not always, I would switch it around, but a lot of the time I do my flies first on chest, then I do my incline press. Same theory, you don't need to use as much weight to get the same results.
Right, and you do eventually become stronger and stronger, even though you're using technically less weight than what you normally would do, but you do get stronger and stronger on that system.
Ridiculously so. It's like a reverse psychology. I mean, I'm working with a guy now, Keith Wallace, and he was a strongman, a powerlifter. And he's repping out with weights that he would never have been able to move as a strongman power, because we've used the pre-exhaustion system with him so much. Initially, and your form's got to be different. You know, like on chest, a lot of guys will drop their elbows to do a bench. Mm-hmm. You drop your elbows, you're working tricep and front delt. So today, when you drop your elbows, you'll be able to lift more weight. But if you bring your elbows back and isolate just the chest, potentially your chest is much bigger, stronger muscle than your front delt or your triceps. So now, if you can work a muscle in that form with your elbows back, the bigger muscle of the three is going to be more developed, and ultimately you're going to get stronger on the exercise because of that. Because your triceps and your front delt are now not the weak link,
right?
If that makes sense.
Absolutely. I'm a huge believer in that system. Huge.
Yeah. So a lot of the time, people that want to be strong will end up getting injured because they're using these smaller muscles to assist the lift.
Yeah.
But the bodybuilders that are not trying to get strong will get incredibly strong because they're using the major muscle rather than those auxiliary muscles. I mean, I was incline benching 5-6 plates a side. I could, you know, I did flies with 190s, you showed it earlier. But I never really tried to get super strong. It just happened because of the
weight. I wish it was that way with money.
Yeah. I know. Tell me about it.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the lifestyle of the professional bodybuilder. And I want to talk about this as it relates to not so much the single guy who has no, you know, responsibilities per se, but I want to talk about it in as it relates to a married guy who maybe even has children, okay? Which I think you have experience in that, am I right?
I absolutely do, yeah. So I got together with my wife and we had a child 92. My daughter was born in 92. It wasn't an issue when she was a baby, but once she got into a toddler, it definitely changed things. You've got to be quite selfish to be a bodybuilder.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all about your next meal, your next workout. It's very easy to get wrapped up into that. But I think if I had carried on, I wouldn't be married. And I probably wouldn't see my kids. And when I was young, I thought bodybuilding was the be-all and end-all. And I think you've got to be like that to be the best at anything. I think you've got to be uncivilized, as it were. But once you fall in love and you've got kids who you adore, I think that changes things. It makes you civilized.
Right.
That's the curse of anything. Where, like bodybuilding or fighting, I think once you get civilized, you've got other things that are on your mind. I think when I was younger, the first thing I thought about when I woke up in the morning was bodybuilding. The last thing I thought about on a night was bodybuilding. Once I met my wife, that's not the first thing I thought about. The first thing I thought about was her. And the last thing I thought about was her.
Okay. Well, I hope she watches this podcast because I'm including this part in.
Yeah, well, I hope she does too. She knows. She knows. But it definitely changes things. It definitely changes things. I think you think of what if. You think if, you know, you think of what if I wasn't here. And up to that point, you didn't care if you weren't here. Mm-hmm. You just do it anyway. It definitely affects a family. I think any sport where you're trying to be the best in the world at it and trying to push it to that level would affect a family. I don't think it can not affect a family. It's tough. It's tough. And, you know, anybody who's married to a bodybuilder, they sacrifice a lot too.
Oh, sure. I mean, let's talk about like the typical day in bodybuilding. Like you said, you wake up in the morning, the first thing you're like, you're thinking about maybe your first meal or your first training session, right? And then you have to physically get up and go to do your first training session and have your first meal. And then after your first meal, all you're thinking about is your first protein shake right after your first training session.
Next meal, yeah.
And then you go home and maybe you want to take a nap because you want to grow a little bit, right? And then you may, if you have one of those routines where you train twice a day, some people do, you're going to go to the gym again at night, right? And then you're going to come home and, you know, there's very little time or thought put into another human being except for yourself. Mm-hmm. So ergo, that's the sort of the narcissistic factor here, right? And it's a bodybuilding, I guess, I think bodybuilding is unique because it's really, this is a 365 day a year, 24/7 sport.
It's the hardest sport in the world, in my opinion. Fighters train hard. They only train hard up to a fight.
Right.
They only have to eat right up to a fight. Bodybuilding, it's like you said, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days of the year.
Yeah.
There's no let up. If you let up, you're going to go backwards.
Right. And if you let up, there's a guy who's not going to let up somewhere. And you're going to lose to that guy.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you are involved in a relationship or you have children, for example, and this is a 24/7, 365 thing, you can't really focus your attention on the family. You really
can't if you're doing it. I mean,
if you're really serious.
If you've got all the money in the world and you don't have to earn a living, then maybe. But I've always worked. I mean, when I turned pro, I was working full time as a cable jointer. So I trained at night when I finished my day's work.
Right.
And then from being 20 year old onwards, I owned a gym. So I literally lived in the gym. I had a room upstairs. I lived there.
Right.
So, you know, it's all consuming. And you can make time for your family, but it's not like a regular relationship.
No. Well, it's almost like you're there, but you're not there.
Yes. Yes.
Right. Because mentally you're somewhere else.
You have to be, because if you're not thinking about your next meal, you might miss it.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
Right. You know? Right.
And honestly, when you train as hard as we used to train, you've kind of got to mentally prepare yourself for it hours before. You can't just like be out on a day in the park having fun with your kids and then suddenly turn your attention and go into the balls out hard workout. I don't know any man that can do that.
I used to get nervous.
I used to get nervous before a workout, like I was having a fight.
Right. Mm-hmm. You get on leg day. If you don't get butterflies in your stomach before leg day, you're not doing it right.
Exactly.
Right. And you said, you know, you can't go and be picking flowers with your daughter in the park and then expect to go in like an animal and do squats until you vomit. I mean, it's just
personalities. It's two different people.
Yeah. It's Jekyll and Hyde, really. Right. In a way. And what's really, really interesting about this sport is bodybuilders don't even get the fame and the fortune other athletes do.
No, but
I mean, it's almost, it's like a very strange, bizarre, it's a bizarre sport to love.
It is. It's crazy. Sometimes I wish I'd never found it. Sometimes I wish I'd been a golfer or something like that. but like you say, once you're kind of in love with it, you're in love with it. You can't get out of your blood.
Well, it's funny you said it, because the guy who used to own the gym that I used to train at, he said, if you don't want to be here, go pick up golf. Get out of here. So,
yeah.
You know, this is a hardcore dungeon gym. You want to be here, you want to be here. That's it.
Yeah.
But I mean, you have a situation here where you're training every day as hard as you can to the detriment of everything else in your life. You don't have these great financial rewards. You don't have fame. You don't have fortune. You have it's a pittance of money compared to other sports.
So why do we do it?
So So why do we do it?
I don't know, man.
I think building a physique, I really believe building a physique is a beautiful thing. It's definitely, it's a cool, the fact that you can sculpt out your body, like Arnold said, like.
You know what I think it is? I think it's your first impressions. I mean, the first time I saw Pumping Iron, I was just gobsmacked by how people could look. And the first professional bodybuilder I ever saw guest pose at a show, the first show I ever went to, was a guy called Greg DeFerro. I ended up competing against him years later in Chicago. But Greg, his nickname was Rocky. He looked like Sylvester Stallone.
Right.
But I remember standing next to that guy as a 14-year-old kid, 15-year-old kid, just in awe. And that never, ever left me. He still hasn't left me to this day.
Wow.
And that, I think that's where it comes from. The look, the amount of respect you have for someone who's done that, and it's just an awe-inspiring thing. I think it never leaves you.
So at some point you made the decision in your life that this sport, this career, basically it simply wasn't worth it. Right. Because the truth is we show the clips of you in the beginning and you have one of the 1% physiques in the world on the planet. Right.
Thank you.
And, I mean, you have no weak body parts, zero. If you look at it genetically, you have calves, you have quads, your arms, your shoulders, everything, the back is ridiculous. Everything's there, right? So there's no missing genetic pieces. And you were huge. I mean, I've stood next to you, you're huge. So at some point, however, you said this sport, it's essentially political, the political football is being thrown around and I can't be used as a tool while these guys are putting money in their pockets and I'm starving.
That's exactly what it was. I mean, I felt at the time that the IFBB thought they had a lot of leeway with me because I was young, so I would be around for a long time. But the sacrifices that I was putting my family through and myself through, it's hard to justify to your wife and your kids that you're away all day, you're sacrificing all this, you're going through all this dieting, and you're coming home with nothing. And it was never really about money for me. It was about success. So when I was getting beaten by guys that I knew deep down weren't as good as me, just because they were more popular or they had more magazine coverage, it's just hard to justify it to your family and yourself eventually. Mm-hmm. You know, you put yourself through the agony of dieting, you put yourself through the agony of training. You know you're coming in better condition, you know you're bigger than another athlete, and then you're still not getting the places you feel like you deserve. And there's only, you know, there's a lot of people that criticize me for retiring so young. But I have no regrets. No. I have no regrets for stepping out when I did. It's a shame that it wasn't kept as a sport. And like you say, it maybe never was. But that's why I'm so passionate about what I'm doing. I'm trying to make it a sport with a PCA where the best man on the stage wins, irrelevant of who sponsors them, irrelevant of who trains them, irrelevant of... I actually made did an interview years ago with a guy called Mathhouse. And I said, bodybuilding should be judged with paper bags over the heads. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't be announced by name. Should be announced by a number and put a paper. Now, it's not practical. You can't do that because you'd trip over, you wouldn't see what you were doing. But
right.
My point was that it shouldn't be a name game. It shouldn't be a popularity contest. It should be about what you see and judge it on what you see on the day. And I think a lot of bodybuilders, a lot of people would probably, a lot more people would probably compete in bodybuilding, or a lot more bodybuilders would have carried on the career longer if that was the case.
Right. So let's talk about this PCA for a minute and tell us what it is and how you got into it and how's it going.
PCA is called the Physical Culture Association. It was started in England probably 5 or 6 years ago now. And when I first heard about it through my nephew, I was dubious, just like everybody else. Well, another bodybuilding federation, you know, it'll never work. Well, I sat back and watched the PCA grow and grow and grow. So I was watching the PCA, and literally every week another country was added. We're now in over 35 countries, some incredible talent. And then in 2018, I went over to England and watched a PCA show, and it blew me away. I couldn't believe it. I actually walked away from that show thinking, why didn't I think of this? Why hadn't this been done earlier? Basically, we don't do a pre-judging and a night show. Because as a bodybuilder, you can't peak for both. You can only peak for one. You can only beat your best for about an hour in true bodybuilding terms. So with PCA, we bring a class out. Let's say it's junior bodybuilders. The class comes out. We do the quarter turns. We do all the comparisons with all the poses. Then every athlete gets a chance to do the posing routine, the full posing routine, which a lot of the federations, over the top 10 get to do that. So every athlete gets a chance to display all the hard work they're putting. And then the judging is done live. So we bring them all out at the end, once they've all done the posing routine, we do a pose down. And then while that pose down is going on, we're correlating the scores. And then we announce the winners I'll be announced the placings immediately. And then those athletes are done for the day. And then the next class comes on. So it's just, it's a federation that is all about the athletes. We do everything in-house. So we save the athletes a lot of money. We're about a third of the cost that any other federation is for membership, for entry fees. We do the tanning ourselves, which is, again, we try to save the athletes money on everything. Because it's there's a big misconception in bodybuilding that there's no money in the sport. Well, that's only true if you're an athlete.
Right.
Yeah. Everybody else makes money out of bodybuilding, but the athletes don't. And unfortunately, with a lot of federations, their whole revenue is generated from the athletes. And PCA don't believe that should be the case. So we're trying to cut all the costs for the athlete and put on a really entertaining show so people want to pay to come and watch the show. So we're trying to make our money from the ticket sales, not the athletes. And to me, that rings true. The fact that we do the judging in real time, and we basically eliminate any politics from the judging. We don't let judges judge people that they've trained or that they have a personal connection to. We'll remove people off the panel. I'm all about fairness. I want to make it a sport again. I want to make it so that the best on the day wins, irrelevant of who they are. You know, and if they are the popular guy, if they're the best, then they'll win. But you shouldn't have to serve your dues. If you're the best on the day and it's your first ever show, you should win.
Right.
Simple as that. So I fell in love with bodybuilding again because of PCA. And I'd literally turned my back on the sport, and this brought me back into it. So I'm very passionate about it. And I honestly believe PCA is the future of the sport. I really do. We're doing it very different. We give two pro cards out, one to a man and one to a woman. Mm-hmm. They are going to be giving more pro cards out, but we're not going to be giving 1,000 out a year. We're not going to water down our pro division. And another thing with those, if you turn pro with PCA, there's no yearly fee. You don't have to pay $300 or $400 to be a PCA pro. You've earned the right to be a pro. And you're part of an elite group. You're not one of many. You're one of few.
That's great. That's great. That's really the way it sounds like. That's the way it should be.
I think so. And I'm passionate about it, and I'm going to stick to my plan. It's working incredibly in England. I mean, in England, PCA is the number one bodybuilding federation now. It's taken over every other federation. And I believe it can do the same in this country too.
Wow. Okay. That's great. So that sounds like it's going in the right direction. I hope that continues to expand here in the U.S.
Thank you, Todd. I appreciate it, man.
Lee, I really appreciate you coming on the show. I've been wanting to do this for a very long time. You know, you were somebody I definitely looked up to. And, you know, we trained together a few times in Florida. So, you know, I find you to be a very, very good guy. I enjoy speaking to you, and I hope we can do this again, maybe a little different topic.
Absolutely. Anytime, just let me know. Thank you, Todd. Thanks for having me.
Okay. And good luck with the PCA.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Very good. And this is where we're going to end it.